So hello guys, very good morning everyone. Welcome to this first lecture on the Engineering Services Prelims Crash Course for Paper 1. So I hope you guys are doing fine and the preparation for Engineering Services 2021 exam is going well. And with the help of these free crash course series, we are also going to cover the almost 95% of the syllabus. Well, we cover everything, but that too in a fast forward manner. Basically, it is a crash course, so in which every day at 1 hour, for a duration of 1 hour, we'll be covering the important topics for all the subjects of Engineering Services Prelims Paper 1. So you know that Paper 1 is very, very important, right? So in that, we'll be covering almost all the subjects. Hi, Chandan, Pass 1, good morning. Dhamni, Saranya, very good morning. Welcome to the session. It is my request to all my dear students, please, forward this session. Please share this session to all your friends who are preparing for the Engineering Services Prelims Paper 1 exam, so that everyone can join in the session. They can get benefited by this session. Okay. So basically, we are going to completely cover the theory of all the topics from the subject of basics of energy environment. Okay. And along with that, at the end of the session, we'll be solving some important questions based on the topics which we have covered. Okay. Hello, Vibhuti. Very good morning. Welcome to the session. Hi, Ayushi, Ajput. Good morning. Welcome to the session. It is my request to all my dear students, please quickly, those who have joined me for the session, please like and share the session also. And subscribe to our Gate Grade Up YouTube channel so that you never get, you get the notification of the videos like this. Okay. Is it for all the branches? Yes, see, paper one is for all the branches. Hi Akshay, very good morning. Welcome to our session. Paper 1, this is basically part of the Paper 1, ESC Paper 1. This series is basically a crash course series for ESC Paper 1 and it is for all the branches. It is for all branches who are preparing for Engineering Services exam. Okay, so if anyone is preparing for this exam, especially the exam which will be conducted on 18th of July, then these sessions are definitely going to help you. Sir, aise hi sare topics ke aayenge crash course. See, all the topics will be covered. Yes, exactly. All the subjects. Not just the subject of basics of energy environment, this is a subject which I am going to take now. Basics of energy and environment. This is the subject which I teach here. Okay. But all the other subjects will also be covered, which is the part of the Engineering Services Prelims Paper 1, like Material Science Engineering, ICT, General Principle of Design, Drawing and Safety, Standard and Quality Practices, all the subjects will be covered. Would be the class PDF will be made available in the Telegram group? Yes, the PDF of this class will be available after the lecture. Okay, you will also get the PDF of the session. Okay, so don't worry about that. Is today non-tech class at 8:30 PM will be there or not? Anu Kumar, definitely it will be there. But that is on different channel. That is on Mechanical Marvels YouTube channel. This class is on the Gate Grade Up YouTube channel. Okay, so that class is definitely going to be there. Okay, so I think we should start the session and I would request everyone, those who have already joined me, please like and share the session and also subscribe our YouTube channel so that, and press the bell icon also so that you get automatic notification of the videos. Now, let us introduce myself a bit so that you can have a little bit information about the faculty also. I am Vikas Bhadauria. I have more than 5+ year teaching experience. I have done my M.Tech in Thermal Engineering from Thapa University and mentored more than 10,000 plus aspirants for different exams like GATE, Engineering Services and SSCJ exams. My area of expertise includes subjects of fluid mechanics, thermal applied and heat transfer subjects. So that is a small introduction about me. Okay, so my dear students, I can see right now we have 27 students live in the session. Can you please forward this session or share this session to your friends in your WhatsApp group, in your Telegram group, or any group you have joined? Please share the session also. Now, let's start the topic. The first lecture is about the energy, the different types of energy. So I have taken a short video. If you have not seen that short video, I have done the weightage analysis for this particular subject of basics of energy environment, in which I have discussed the previous year weightage and some of the important previous year questions. So my dear students, in this particular session, we'll be discussing the concept of different types of energy, renewable and non-renewable energy. Okay, so let's start the session. PDF available in which Telegram channel? I will send the link for the PDF also. The link for the PDF is already given in the description of this video. Okay, in which the PDF will be available. Let's talk about what is the meaning of energy, my dear student, to understand the different types of energies. Energy may be defined as the capacity to do work. It is used in the sectors such as industries, commerce, transport, telecommunication, and wide range of agricultural and household activities. Now, this energy, if you talk about energy is the capacity to do work, there are different types of energy like mechanical energy, thermal energy, electrical energy, different types of energies are there. Okay, but if you do the classification of the energy, it can be classified into basically two types. Yeah, is it 20 minute? Yeah, definitely I'm talking about that 20 minute video. We are doing the classification of the energy resources. Energy can be classified mainly in two types, renewable energy and non-renewable energy sources. Okay, now what is renewable energy? Renewable energy such as wind energy, water, solar and geothermal come from the sources that regenerate fast as they consume and continuously available. I hope that this classification you already know what is the meaning of renewable. Renewable means something which can be renewed again and again. Which can be renewed again. That means even if you are consuming that energy resource, it is going to renew itself. Which can be renewed again and again. As you consume the resource, it will be renewed. Okay, it is never going to be exhausted. Okay, now non-renewable energy resources are those which cannot be renewed like renewable energy. They take particular period of time like 200 or 300 years or maybe millions of years for their formation. Okay, so these energy resources, if exhausted, are exhausted, or if they are consumed, they will take millions of years to regenerate. So basically, the period of regeneration is very large in the non-renewable energy sources. That is why they call non-renewable. Okay, while these renewable energy they can be renewed like. As you consume these resources, they are renewed. Okay, they are never going to be exhausted. For example, wind energy, the energy from the wind, water, solar energy from the sun, geothermal energy from the earth. These are called renewable energy. See, my dear students, I can understand you are asking about these questions. You will be having your question, that queries, that is normal. See, my dear students, this is a crash course. In the crash course, we will try to cover the theory in a very, you know, fast forward manner, in a way that all the theory should be covered. At the end of the session, we will be also discuss some relevant questions from the topics which have been covered. Okay, so at the end of the session, we will also discuss the questions. The non-renewable energy sources such as fossil fuel and nuclear material are extracted from the earth and can be depleted in the near future. Yes. If you consume these resources, non-renewable, they will definitely get depleted, means they will be completely exhausted in the future. For example, coal, petroleum, natural gas, these are all called as non-renewable energy. Now, if you do the classification of this energy with the help of this diagram, you can see conventional and non-conventional. This is another classification. Now you need to understand what is the difference between conventional and non-conventional and renewable and non-renewable. Renewable, as you understand, renewable and non-renewable, it is the classification of energy based on how much time that energy is going to take for regeneration. Renewable energy will be regenerated in a very short period of time, like it is always available. It is never going to, as you consume it, it will be available. But non-renewable energy is going to take millions of years to again be available to the humans or to the earth. Okay, now what is the meaning of conventional and non-conventional? This is also a classification based on how much duration or from how long time this classification is based on the time interval we have been using the resources. Okay, so this is the classification based on from how long time we have been using the resources. For example, conventional energy is that energy which we are using from a very long time. Okay, the energy which we are using from very long time, that is called as conventional energy. For example, fossil fuel, nuclear power, hydropower, these energies are something which we are using from like 300, 400, 500 years. Okay, from last 300 to 400 years, if we are using some energy, that is called as conventional energy that we have been using in a practice of using this energy from a very long time. Non-conventional, on the other hand, means which we started the energy which we started to use from last, we can say 10 to 50 years. From last 10 to 50 years, we have been using this energy resources. That is called non-conventional. Non-conventional means something which we have been not following for a very long time. Okay, so jis energy ka use hum bahut samay se nahi kar rahe, recently humne start kiya from last 10 to 50 years, that is called non-conventional. And the energy which we have been using from a very long time, like before 1900 or before that, the energy which we have been using, like fossil fuel. What is fossil fuel? Coal, petroleum, gas, natural gas. So these energy we have been using from a very long time. Nuclear power was used even during the World War. So you can understand from how long time we have been using that. Hydropower, the energy from water. Okay, the energy from water. Now you can easily understand that some of these conventional energy comes under the renewable, and some of the non-conventional comes under the renewable and non-renewable. Can you tell me the name of that? For example, hydropower. Hydropower is a conventional energy, but it comes under the renewable energy. It is conventional and renewable, my dear. But these two are called as conventional and non-renewable. These two are conventional and non-renewable. Okay, solar energy, wind energy, geothermal, tidal, biomass, they all come under non-conventional and renewable. This energy comes under non-conventional and renewable, while shale gas and syngas, these two energies comes under the non-conventional and non-renewable. Have you all understood the difference between these two energies? Conventional and non-conventional, and renewable and non-renewable? Yes. Please tell me, everyone. Have you all understood the major difference between these two types of energy? Conventional means which we have been using from a very long time, which we have been in a practice of using from a very long time, like fossil fuel, nuclear, hydropower. But in this conventional also, we have got both renewable and non-renewable. These two comes under non-renewable and conventional energy. Hydropower comes under the conventional and renewable energy. Solar energy, wind energy, geothermal, tidal, biomass comes under non-conventional and renewable energy, while shale gas and syngas comes under non-conventional and non-renewable energy. That is a basic difference between these energies. Under renewable and non-renewable, we have got this classification. These are the non-renewable energy already discussed, and these are the renewable energy, okay? Like hydropower, solar, wind, geothermal, tidal, biomass. So you need to understand the differences between the conventional and non-conventional, and renewable and non-renewable. Please describe. See, this is the start of the lecture, my dear Nishan. I will discuss all the types of energy. Don't worry. This lecture is going to be continue for 1 hour. Okay, so you will be understanding all the types of energy here. So we have discussed that energy resources are classified into non-renewable and renewable. Under non-renewable, we have got fossil fuel and nuclear power. In fossil fuel, we study coal, petroleum, natural gas, shale gas, coal bed methane gas, syngas. They all come under the fossil fuel. Under nuclear energy, we study the nuclear energy from uranium, thorium and thermonuclear energy. Okay, so these are basically the fuels, or we can say fuels used in nuclear fission reaction. You know that in nuclear energy, that to utilize the nuclear energy, the type of reaction which take place is called nuclear fission reaction. Okay, so these are the different types of fuel we use for that: uranium, thorium and thermonuclear energy. In renewable energy, we have two types: biofuels and abiotic resources. Kindly provide a good number of question as per UPSC 50 is very less. Lakshmi, I don't understand. You are talking about the number of questions for this particular class. See, in each class, we'll be covering around 5 to 6 questions. So total 30 questions will be covering in this theory classes, and one class will be for numerical, in which I will cover 25 questions. So it will be obviously 50 questions. It's not possible to provide both theory and numerical in 1 hour lecture. You need to understand. You cannot get everything here. It is a crash course series where I will be providing you theory and numerical both. So try to understand this thing. If I have to provide you numericals, then my dear, I cannot provide you the theory also. Both the things cannot be provided in a 1 hour lecture. Biofuels like biomass, biogas, bioethanol, biodiesel, they are biofuels. Abiotic resources. See, biotic and abiotic. Biotic and abiotic. See, if you want to practice the question, Lakshmi, you can join the mock test. Okay, you can take the mock test after these classes. Okay, it is not that here only you will practice the question. You can take the mock test also. You can solve the previous year questions. And you can join our Mechanical Marvels YouTube channel, in which we are providing 400 questions of paper 1, entire paper 1 subjects. Biotic means living components. It is my request to everyone, please focus on the lecture, because I have got very less time to cover everything. I have to cover the theory, so please focus on the lecture first. Living components of environment. Yeah, exactly, we'll be covering the entire syllabus. Please focus on the lecture, because if I have to engage in the conversation, in the queries, then how can I cover the lectures? How can I cover everything? I have got a very limited time to cover, so please focus on the lecture first. Living components of the environment are called biotic components. Abiotic means non-living components. Non-living components of the environment. So, under abiotic sources of renewable energy, we have hydro energy, geothermal energy, solar energy, wind, hydrogen and ocean energy. They all come under the abiotic sources. Now, solar energy, if we talk about, what is solar energy? Solar energy is the energy from sun. It is the energy we receive from sun. Now, what is the sun? We know that sun is basically a sphere of very hot gases like hydrogen and helium. In the core of the sun, we have temperature of 10 power 7 Kelvin, and at the surface of the sun we have temperature of 5880 Kelvin. Okay, the source of energy in sun is nuclear fusion reaction. भाई अगर ESC में नहीं आता है तो आप बेटा, अगर आपको पता है इसके बारे में क्या आता क्या नहीं आता है, for that you have to see the previous year question. What kind of question comes in the exam? If this looks hard to you, then my dear, it is the paper 1 will be very difficult for you. And in that case, okay, See, why are you guys are having these questions? Syllabus is vast, how can you get? See, it is a crash course. Why don't you understand this simple thing? It is a crash course. Do not engage in the conversation how it is going to be covered or not. That is my responsibility to cover that. Please focus on the lecture first. Nuclear fusion. Nuclear fusion reaction is a source of energy. Now, the kind of questions you are asking like that, it is definitely not going to help me in covering the entire syllabus. So it is my request to everyone, please focus on the lecture. Source of energy in the sun is nuclear fusion reaction. What is nuclear fusion reaction? Nuclear fusion reaction is a reaction. It is a chemical reaction. Chemical reaction in which very small molecules join together to form a big molecule. Okay, big molecule, that is called as nuclear fusion reaction. Example of a nuclear fusion reaction is when four hydrogen atoms combine to form a helium atom. Form helium. That is one kind of reaction. Like that, very similar kind of millions of reaction take place, which is responsible for the energy in the sun. Now, when the solar energy comes to the earth, that solar energy can be utilized in two ways. One way is called solar thermal system. Another is called solar photovoltaic system. In solar thermal system, what we try to do, we collect the radiant heat. Sun contains a lot amount of energy in the form of heat, and that heat is in the form different types of radiations come from the sun, like X rays, gamma rays, UV rays, visible rays, infrared rays. So these different types of radiations that comes from the sun, they are basically collected with the help of a device called solar collectors. So here we use solar collectors. With the help of solar collectors, we collect the radiant heat and use it in a thermal system like water heating applications, swimming pool heating, space heating, and power generation for generation of electricity. So we can use the solar energy. The heat of the solar energy can be basically collected in a solar collector, and with the help of the solar collector, we can heat a particular kind of a fluid, and we can use that hot fluid for water heating, swimming pool heating, space heating, cooling, and power generation. Second way of utilizing the solar energy is by collecting and converting it directly to electrical energy using a photovoltaic system. There are basically two technology of utilizing the solar energy. One is called solar thermal system, other is called solar photovoltaic system. Okay. Now, in solar thermal system, we have different types of devices like solar collectors, solar passive space heating and cooling system, solar water heaters, solar refrigeration and air conditioning system, solar cooker, solar dryer. Okay. Solar collectors. What is solar collector? Solar collector, it is a device which is used to capture radiations, or collect radiation from sun. Okay, so that device is called solar collector. With the help of the solar collector is a very important component of solar thermal system. In solar thermal system, we try to utilize the heat of the sun, and that heat of the sun is utilized in solar collector for heating a particular type of fluid. That can be water, that can be any kind of fluid. That fluid is heated, and with the help of heating, we can basically use that hot fluid for any kind of application, whether it is space heating or cooling application, solar water heater, solar refrigeration, air conditioning, solar cooker or solar dryer, and also can be used for solar thermal power plant. In solar thermal power plants also we use this system. Okay, this is the example of a solar cooker. You can see that this is a solar collector. solar collector, which is used for as a component of solar thermal system. Solar cooker, which is placed at the center. This is the solar cooker in which you can put your you can put your rice, pulses, vegetables, whatever you want to cook here. So this solar cooker is basically based on parabolite disc collector. This is called parabolite disc collector. This is also one kind of a collector. Okay. And in this collector, the temperature, you can reach the temperature of 400 to 600 degrees Celsius. This much amount of high temperature can be achieved by this collector. It can produce this much amount of temperature. Okay. This is example of a solar water heater. This is also comes under the solar thermal system. And this is a collector which is used. This is called as evacuated flat plate collector. This is also a solar collector which is called evacuated flat plate collector. This is used in the solar water heater application. Now this is basically called as parabolic collectors. Parabolic collectors, or it is called parabolic trough collector. Now this is used in the this collector is basically used in the solar thermal systems. Solar thermal system. It can produce the temperature. It can produce the temperature in the range of we can say up to 1000 to 1200 degrees Celsius. This much amount of high temperature can be produced by this type of collector. So these technology were called solar thermal system technology. Now we are going to discuss about solar PV system, solar photovoltaic system technology. Solar photovoltaic system is another technology which is used to utilize the solar energy. In this technology, we directly convert. It is direct conversion of sunlight into electricity. So this technology is called solar PV system technology, in which we use a device called solar array or solar PV plate. It is also called solar PV system, or it is also called solar PV panel. Now solar PV panel is basically consist of a very important component that is called solar cell. The very small segment, the very small member is called as solar cell. This is a device, this is a component which is the most costly component of the solar PV panel system is solar cell. This solar cell will, when the solar energy falls on the solar cell, and this solar cell is basically made of, it is made of semiconductor material, which contains electrons and protons. So when the solar cell, when the light from the sun falls on the solar cell, then there will be a movement of the electron in an electric circuit. And because of the movement of the electrons, electric current will be produced, and that current can be stored in a battery. Okay. And with the help of, and that current is basically a DC current. DC current is stored in the battery. Now that DC current can be directly used for some application. Some devices which are based on DC load, or with the help of an inverter, we can convert that into AC, and we can use for the devices which are based on alternating current. AC means alternating current, and DC means direct current. So remember that this technology directly converts the solar energy into electricity, and the component which we use for this is called solar cell. That is smallest component, but it is the most costly component. It is very costly. The most costly is the main problem of this solar PV system is that the solar cell is very costly. The technology, this technology is very costly, especially the solar cell. What is the advantage of solar energy? The solar energy is free and renewable to generate electricity, but requires collectors and some other equipment for conversion of solar energy into electrical energy. Solar cells are used for power generation, causes no noise. We are talking about solar PV system technology. They will not produce any kind of noise, whereas generator or turbines of other method cause noise pollution. Other method means if we have to produce electricity, what we use in our country, especially in any power plant, what we require a turbine and a generator. These are the two important components. But in this technology of solar PV system, we don't require a turbine or generator. We just require a solar PV system and a battery. Whatever amount of electricity will be produced, it will be stored in a battery and that can be used for later use. It does not cause much pollution compared to other power generation methods like thermal power plant, nuclear power plant and so on. The solar cell do not consist of any moving parts and hence requires a little maintenance for their operation. It can be used in remote area for generating and remote means like the areas. What is the meaning of remote areas? Areas far away from city. Far away from cities. That is called as remote areas. Okay. It can be used in remote area for generating utilizing power in that locality where the transmission electricity is too expensive. Okay. In those areas, we can use this solar PV system technology. But what are the disadvantages of this technology, solar energy? The solar energy power generation entirely depends on the sunlight incident on the solar panels and which in turn depends on the climatic conditions. So that is one problem of solar energy, that solar energy is not available every time. It depends, it is available only during the daytime, and also it is during the daytime it is affected by the weather conditions. Okay. So it will not be available during the very winters. During the winter also sometimes it's not available due to foggy condition, and during the rainy season also it is not available. Solar energy can be harnessed in a limited period as the sunlight is available only during the daytime and sunny days. This power can be generated only in limited time period and the power has to be saved in the battery for later usage. That is one problem. The battery used to store the solar power are very costly, huge size and need to be replaced from time to time. The efficiency of solar power system, conversion of solar energy into electrical energy is around 22%. And for improving this, large areas are required to capture more sunlight and produce adequate electricity. So basically one disadvantage is that large investment or large land investment is required. Large land investment is required for solar energy. For utilizing the solar energy, if you have to use the solar energy, we have to, if you have to make a solar power plant, solar thermal power plant or solar PV power plant, then you require a very large area of land. So that is one problem. Kitna question aata hai, dekhiye beta, I can answer this question, but do you think that this is the right time to ask this question? You can ask any question at the end of the session. I have to cover a lot of things, my dear. Try to focus on that. Wind energy or wind power describes the process by which wind is used to generate mechanical power or electricity. Okay. So what is wind energy? The source of the wind energy is also sun somehow. Why? Because sun will heat the surface of the earth and surface of the ocean. So when the air will get heated up, solar energy, when falls on land and water, it causes differential heating means the air on land gets heated and rises in form of wind. That is called wind energy basically. Okay, so actually the source of the wind energy is also somehow sun energy, solar energy. Because solar energy, when falls on the earth, it will heat the air. The heated air will rise because of low density, and that air is going to be the source of wind energy. Now, wind energy is also different types. The wind having speed of more than 25 km per hour can be used for windmill. This is a minimum speed which is required for the wind to be used in the windmill for power generation. So this, you can see windmills, you can find these windmills in the areas of Gujarat and some coastal area. Especially in the coastal areas, you will find this wind energy power plants. Okay. like Odisha and Gujarat, you will find most of the wind energy power plant in those areas. Now, wind energy converts the kinetic energy of the wind into mechanical power. This mechanical power can be used for a specific task such as grinding grain or pumping water, or a generator can convert this mechanical power into electricity. So that is a very simple energy, wind energy. Maybe one question can be asked, but not always. Important topics are solar energy from this topic and biomass energy. Next is hydrogen fuel cell. I think once a question came from hydrogen fuel cell also, so I think we should discuss about this also. Hydrogen fuel cells is a very new technology. It is a modern technology, modern renewable energy technology. Renewable energy is also called as green energy, okay, because it will not produce pollution like non-renewable energy. So hydrogen, in hydrogen fuel cell, it is basically energy conversion, a fuel cell is a device that generates electricity by a chemical reaction. So basically, in this chemical energy is directly converted to electrical energy in the hydrogen fuel cell. The chemical energy is directly converted into electricity. The chemical energy of the fuel is converted into electricity. So here you can see in this hydrogen fuel cell, the basic source of the fuel is basically hydrogen. Hydrogen is acted as a fuel and it requires oxygen also. So it basically contains two electrodes. One is called anode. Anode is also called as fuel electrode, on which fuel is going to come, and cathode is called as oxygen electrode, on which oxygen will come. So on this side you can see the fuel will come, basically hydrogen comes from here. Now this hydrogen fuel is going to get basically the hydrogen ions will release as soon as they will pass on this anode, okay, and when this hydrogen ions will be released, two hydrogen ions will be passed from an electric circuit. These two hydrogen ions will be passed from an external circuit. This is your external circuit. With the help of this external circuit, two hydrogen ions will pass to the other side of the electrode, which is called cathode. Now, these two electrons will combine with the oxygen to make oxygen ions. So, final reaction will be hydrogen plus oxygen will give you water plus electricity. This will be the reaction will come from here. So the in exhaust of hydrogen fuel cell ka exhaust kya hota hai? Water. It is water actually, and that is why it is also called clean energy, because it will not cause any pollution, because hydrogen fuel cell will have exhaust of water only, okay, water and electricity, okay. And at the center of the between these two electrodes will be having an electrolyte. Electrolyte is basically used as a charge carrier. It is a charge carrier. It acts as charge carrier, which transfers hydrogen ions to cathode. Okay, this is electrolyte. Okay, now what is the mechanism of this hydrogen fuel cell? Hydrogen atoms enters a fuel cell at the anode and gets ionized as positive ions by the losing electrons. So what will happen? Hydrogen will convert into 2H plus ions plus 2 electrons, and these oxygen will combine with 2 electrons to make oxygen ions. Okay, when this hydrogen and oxygen will finally combine, they will make water. So this is a reaction which will take place. The hydrogen ions travel through the electrolyte to form water, combining with oxygen ions. With the combined, the chemical reaction generates an electric flow continuously. So this is the hydrogen fuel cell. What are the advantages of hydrogen fuel cell? The fuel cell technology offer high conversion efficiency. The conversion efficiency is around 50%. This is the conversion efficiency of the conversion efficiency means how much amount of chemical energy is converted into electrical energy. So around 50% is the conversion efficiency of the hydrogen fuel cell. It provides modularity and compactness and noise-free operations. What is the application of this fuel cell? It can be used in small power generation cell. It can be used in 2 and 3 wheelers, motorcycle, and also in heavy vehicles. It is used in catalytic combustion system for residential industrial. It is used in space capsule rockets. It is also used in basically 2 and 3 wheelers. We use direct methanol fuel cell. Different types of fuel cells are there. We use direct methanol fuel cell in the in operating of the heavy vehicles. Okay, so these are the advantage disadvantage of fuel cell. Let's talk about the biomass energy. This is the final renewable energy. Biomass is a renewable energy source because the energy contains from the sun. It is also the how the energy biomass energy is from the energy from sun, because the source of the biomass energy, very good afternoon Pavan, welcome to the session. Source of biomass energy is, the main source of the biomass energy is plants. Now plants prepare their food, they prepare their food by photosynthesis, which requires solar energy. So ultimately biomass energy, the source of biomass energy is also somewhat sun also, right? So biomass plant material is a renewable energy source because it contains energy from the sun. So obviously baat hai, this energy will be available for a long time. Biomass is the organic matter produced by plants, both terrestrial and aquatic, and their derivatives. Biomass is commonly plant matter grown to generate electricity or produce heat. In the biomass energy, this type of reaction comes. Solar energy is used for photosynthesis reaction to make biomass, and that biomass can be used for electricity generation. There are different usable form of the biomass like biodiesels. Biodiesels are basically made by transesterification reaction. Transesterification reaction of vegetable oil. So by the transesterification reaction of different types of vegetable oil will make biodiesels. It is converted into ethanol or ethyl alcohol and methanol ethyl alcohol to be used as liquid fuel in the engines. Now this biodiesel can be mixed with, what is B20? B20 means, it means that it is 20% biodiesel, 20% biodiesel and 80% petroleum diesel. Why it is called biodiesel first of all? Because this biodiesel is basically a mixture of diesel fuel and some vegetable oil fuel, which is called biodiesel. If it is purely biodiesel, it is called B100. B100 means pure biodiesel. It is called as pure biodiesel, that is called B100. If it is B20, it is called a mixture of 20% biodiesel and 80% petroleum diesel. Then wood and charcoal, they are also source of biomass. Bioethanol. Ethanol is basically made by, it is made by fermentation. It is made by the fermentation of sweet plants. The plants which are sweets like sugarcane, starches, grains, potatoes, cellulose. So this is where do we use this biodiesel? Biodiesel are used in, this biodiesel is used in the diesel engine. It is used in the diesel engine, my dear. Okay. Biogas is basically, biogas is also one of the source. Biogas is made by fermentation of the biomass anaerobically to obtain a gaseous fuel called biogas. Because of the low pressure and highly inert reaction, it is used in mobile vehicles and large scale. Producer gas is made by the gasification of the solid fuel, generally used in the intake stroke with air to reduce. It is also used in the engines and for cooking application in the village, we use the biogas, right? In the biogas plant, we make this biogas. So what are the different sources of the biomass? The biomass has got different sources like forest residue and agriculture residue, like crop residue, standing biomass, biomass energy plantation. Biomass energy plantation means those plants which are basically produced so that they can be used, they can be generating of some energy. There are some plants which are called energy plants, like Karan, Jatropha, Euphorbia. These are called energy plants. Plantation of 30 million hectares would produce enough biodiesel to prevent use of the fossil fuel in the country. Sugar plant, there are different types of sugar plants also, like sugar plants are used in the ethanol production, like sugar cane, sweet sorghum and sugar beet. They are called as sugar plants. They are used for the ethanol production or biofuel production. Starch plants like Jerusalem, artichoke, cassava, grains. बेटा बार्क इजी है या फिर गेट, ये सेशन ये दिस इज वी कैन डिस्कस दैट एट द एंड ऑफ द सेशन. प्लीज इफ यू आर प्रिपेयरिंग फॉर एसी एग्जाम प्लीज फोकस फॉर दिस सेशन. लेट्स टॉक अबाउट द बायोगैस माय डियर. बायोगैस इज अ फ्लेबल फ्यूल गैस विद 60% मीथेन. दिस इज द मेन कंसेंट्रेशन ऑफ द बायोगैस. इट कंटेन्स 60% ऑफ मीथेन. दिस इज द मीथेन. सो वॉट इज मेनली कंटेन इन द बायोगैस? मिथेन, 60% मिथेन एंड रेस्ट इज कार्बन डाइऑक्साइड. This gas can be upgraded by removal of carbon dioxide with water scrubbing. So basically we can remove the carbon dioxide and we can get pure methane from this by water scrubbing method. Biogas typically refers to the gas produced by biological breakdown of organic matter in absence of oxygen. Absence of oxygen is basically called as absence of oxygen is also called as anaerobic. This is a word we use for the absence of oxygen. So it is basically made by anaerobic decomposition of organic matter. This is how we produce the biogas. Biogas is produced by anaerobic digestion or fermentation. Then this type of biogas basically contains methane and carbon dioxide. And if it is produced by gasification of the wood or other biomass, then this type of gas contains nitrogen, hydrogen, carbon monoxide with trace amount of methane. So actually this is basically the producer gas we are talking about. Producer gas is produced by gasification of the solid fuel and biogas is produced by the anaerobic decomposition of the wet biomass. So biogas is produced by anaerobic decomposition of organic matters like cow dung and the waste of the plant, rice husk and all. And producer gas is produced by the gasification. Total how many sessions? There will be total 6 sessions. Question number next, biofuel applications. What is the application of biofuel? Biofuel can be used as a biodiesel. Biodiesel is what? Biodiesel is nothing but vegetable oil, edible oil and other different types of oil can be used, can be blended with or mixed with. Blended means mixed with petroleum diesel and can be used as a fuel in the CI engine. CI engine is also called diesel engine. It can be used in the diesel engine and it is also called as an alternative fuels. Generally, we use the fuels like petroleum and diesel, petrol or diesel, but biodiesel is also an alternative to petrol and diesel. It is simple to use biodegradable non-toxic Rudolf diesel. Rudolf diesel is one who gave the diesel engine. Initially designed his engine to use peanut oil and his first working prototype was given on 10th of August 1993. August 10 has been declared as International Biodiesel Day. Because on 10th of August only he has made his first engine which was based on biodiesel and that was based on peanut oil. That biodiesel was based on, it was made from peanut oil. The raw vegetable oil is upgraded as biodiesel during a chemical process called transesterification. It gives two products, methyl or ethyl esters, which is also called biodiesel, and glycerine, which is a byproduct to be used in the soap and other products. So during transesterification, you get biodiesel, which is nothing but called methyl or ethyl ester. And as a byproduct, you get glycerine, which is used to make these soaps. Biodiesel refers to pure fuel when before blending with diesel fuel. Biodiesel blends are denoted by BXX. XX represents the percentage of biodiesel contained in the blend. B20 denotes 20% biodiesel, 80% petroleum diesel. B100 is pure biodiesel. During anaerobic decomposition, H2S gas is also released. See, obviously there are different types of gases which are released, but it is not that what kind of anaerobic decomposition you are trying to do. If it is anaerobic decomposition of organic matter, then only methane gas comes along with some carbon dioxide. Biofuel application, bioethanol, it is colorless liquid biofuel. Its boiling point is 78 degrees Celsius and energy density is 26.9. It can be derived from wet biomass containing sugar. Ye yaad rakhega, bioethanol is made from sugar plants like sugar cane, sugar beet, sweet sorghum, starch plants like potato and cassava, and cellulose like woody matter. Commercial ethanol is used in IC engine. It is used in the internal combustion engine. Like petrol engines, it is used in petrol engine. Blends up to 20%. Blend means mixture. If you mix this with mixture up to 22% of anhydrous ethanol. Anhydrous means no water. If it is not containing any water, it is pure ethanol with gasoline or petrol. If you mix 20%, 22% of the bioethanol with petrol, then you don't need to modify the petrol engine. You can directly combine 22% of the pure ethanol with petrol and you can use it directly in the petrol engine. Okay. What is the advantage of the biomass? It is a renewable energy source. The energy storage is an inbuilt feature of it. It is indigenous. Indigenous means it can be basically started indigenously. That means you don't require a very big manpower or big industrial setup for that. Even a single person, if you want to start a biogas plant, you can start it in your village. It is an indigenous source requiring little or no foreign exchange. You don't require any foreign exchange or foreign help. It can be done within your country without any foreign help. The forestry and agriculture industry that supply the feedstock also provides substantial economic development opportunity in the rural areas. So if you start any plant or biogas plant, then you can also provide some employment to the people in the rural areas, because biogas plants are generally set in the rural areas. The pollutant emissions from combustion of biomass are usually lower than that from fossil fuel. Commercial use of biomass may avoid or reduce the problem of waste disposal in the other industries, particularly municipal solid waste in the urban centers. One thing I want to tell you here, this biomass, my dear students, biomass, what is biomass? Biomass is nothing but it can be some organic matters, organic waste of animals and plants. So this biomass is generally used to produce, it is used in to make the biogas in a biogas plant. Okay. Also, you can directly use this biomass. You can use this biomass. Biomass, this is one source for making the, for making biogas. For making biogas, what you require the waste of the animals, like gobar, the gobar of the animals or excreta of the animals and plants. You use that for making the biogas. Now, this biomass can also be directly used in the form of wood, in the form of fossil fuel. You can also use this biomass. You can use this biomass in the form of charcoal. You can use this biomass in the form of ethanol, biodiesel. Okay. Use of the biogas plant, apart from supplying clean gas, also leads to improved sanitation, better hygienic condition in the rural areas as harmful decaying biomass gets stabilized. The nitrogen-rich biodigested slurry. Slurry means in the biogas plant. In biogas plants, we make a slurry of. In biogas plant, we make a slurry. We make a slurry of organic waste, organic waste biomass, and water. Okay. So from that slurry, you will get biogas. Along with biogas, the remains from that slurry will contain some nitrogen-rich biodigested slurry, and sludge from a biogas plant serve as a very good soil conditioner. Soil conditioner means it improves the fertility of the soil. Varying capacity can be installed and any capacity can be operated even at lower load. Limitation of biomass energy is that low concentration of biomass per unit of area of land. Collection and transportation of biomass is expensive due to high moisture content. Yes, it is one problem. For example, wood. If we talk about the wood, if you have to transport the wood, that wood can capture moisture very easily. So that is one problem of moisture. Cost of energy production in the urban areas is high. Large land areas required, hence this method cannot be used in areas where land cost is very high. So it can be used in mostly in the rural areas. What are the disadvantages of the biogas? It is a land and dispersed and land intensive source. That means large amount of land is required. Large amount of land is required. So it is a land intensive source. It is often of low energy density. It is also labor intensive and cost of collecting large quantity for commercial application is significant. Most current commercial application of biomass energy use material that has been collected for other reasons such as timber, food, processing residue and urban waste. Capacity is determined by availability of biomass and not suitable for varying loads, not feasible to set up at all location. What is the topic? The topic is basically the renewable and non-renewable energy. That is, see, if you don't know the topic of the lecture, can't you see in the YouTube channel it is given the topic, my dear. The topic of the lecture is already given in the YouTube channel. Slide spending expect tarike. You can interpret how you want to interpret. जैसे आपको जैसे समझना है वैसे समझ सकते हैं साहिल सौरभ, ठीक है? आपको स्लाइड पढ़ने के एक सौ एक तरीके समझने हैं तो आप YouTube में और भी सर्च कर सकते हैं। यहाँ पे आपको मैं इंजीनियरिंग सर्विसेज की पेपर वन की तैयारी करा रहा हूँ, इसका नाम है क्रैश कोर्स सीरीज। क्रैश कोर्स में और कैसे मैं आपको तैयारी कराऊंगा? आपको क्या लगता है, यहाँ पे मैं पूरा 60 घंटे के लेक्चर दे सकता हूँ क्या आपको? मैं नहीं दे सकता ना। सो इन 6 hours आई हैव टू कवर एवरीथिंग, सो ट्राई टू अंडरस्टैंड इट। Let's talk about the non-renewable energies like coal. Coal is the most abundant conventional source of energy which could be last for at least 200 years. It is a black brown sedimentary rock. This involves a long process that takes place over a long period of time. You know that coal is a non-renewable energy. It is a non-renewable energy. It takes millions of years. It takes millions of years for its formation. But after its formation, it will last for only at least 200 years. That is the maximum time, maximum amount of time you can use this non-renewable energy. Because after 200 or 300 years, this coal, the source of the coal, that is coal mines, the coal in the coal mines is going to get exhaust. And what we are going to do after that? That is why we need to focus on the renewable energy like solar energy, wind energy, geothermal energy, biomass energy. Because after 200, 300 years, there will be no coal. And you know that 67% of electricity generation in our country is through coal power plant, coal based power plants. So most of the power plant that are used in our country, they use coal as a raw material for generating the heat, for producing the heat during combustion. So 67% of the dependence on the electricity is through coal in our country. So we have to look for the other energy resources. HPCL ka exam kab hoga? I don't know when HPCL exam will be conducted. There have been no dates. So far dates have not been announced. Okay, my dear. This involves a long process that takes place over a long period of time. Obviously, it takes millions of years. It takes millions of years for coal formation. Bahut saal lag jate hain, millions of years lag jate hain for the formation of the coal. Coal helps for various processes such as heating of the house, as fuel for the boilers and steam engines, and for generation of the electricity by thermal plants. It constitutes about 70% of the total commercial energy consumption in the country. Like I told you, around 67 to 70% of the electricity generation is through coal. Coal is the most important source of energy. There are more than 1,48,790 coal deposits in India. Between 2005 to 2006, the annual production went up to 343 million tons. India is the fourth largest coal producing country and deposits are mostly found in Bihar, Odisha, Madhya Pradesh and Bengal. Okay. See, how I could know the probable dates of the HPCL exam. अगर मुझे आइडिया भी होता तो मैं आपको बता देता ना बेटा, मैं आपको क्यों छुपाता आपसे, बताइए। Why I would hide, I will hide from you the date of HPCL exam. I don't believe in the guesswork. How I can guess it is? It will be in the month of July, June. If I say it will be June, will it be in June? So no team from HPCL has contacted me for regarding the date. They have not told me what is the date of HPCL exam. I'm waiting for the notification. So you should also wait for the notification. Let's talk about petroleum and natural gas. Petroleum is a mixture of hydrocarbons like alkanes and cycloalkanes. In crude form means raw form, or we can also sometimes call it as crude oil. It is also called petroleum or crude petroleum. In crude form, black liquid is known as petroleum, and the formation of a natural gas occurs when the gas comes in contact with the petroleum layer. Okay. Natural gas is a mixture of 50 to 90% of methane, ethane, propane, butane, and hydrogen sulfide. So these are the basically composition of natural gas. This is important. They can ask you in the exam also, what is the composition of natural gas? What is the composition of natural gas? After refining and purifying crude petroleum, it is available as petrol, diesel, lubricating oil, plastic, etc. Natural gas is also making a significant contribution to household sector. It causes less air pollution as compared to fossil fuel. So this natural gas can be used as, it can be used as in LPG cylinder, and it can be used in CNG also. It is also called liquefied petroleum gas, and LPG stand for liquefied petroleum gas that is used in the cylinders. Liquefied petroleum gas. And CNG stand for compressed natural gas. Compressed natural gas. So it can be used in these two forms. You can use it either in LPG or CNG. Nuclear energy. A small amount of radioactive substance. What is nuclear energy? The energy produced by nuclear fission reaction of radioactive fuels. What are radioactive fuels? Radioactive fuels which produce radiation during their use, like uranium. Basically, uranium-235 is used as a fuel. Uranium, thorium. So these are called radioactive fuels, which are used as a source of fuel in nuclear energy. Okay. A small amount of radioactive substance can produce a lot of energy through nuclear. Large amount of energy is produced from this nuclear energy. But along with that, you also get large amount of radioactive materials. Radioactive substance are released during nuclear energy. That is why it is very important, very critical source of energy, nuclear energy. It is also being, aisa kehte hain, it is also being told that during Mahabharata, at the time of Mahabharata, when they use Brahmastra is also some kind of nuclear energy they used to use. This, if you use that nuclear energy, it is going to completely wipe out the existence of a particular place. For example, when nuclear energy was used by USA on Japan, on Hiroshima and Nagasaki. So the effect of that nuclear weapon is still felt in the Japan, still now. You can feel the effect of that. In order to obtain nuclear energy, nuclear reactions are essential, and there are about 300 nuclear reactions. Nuclear energy is one of the most environmentally friendly conventional source of energy, as it produces fewer greenhouse gases. See, if you talk about causing the pollution to the environment, it will not cause pollution. But it will not cause pollution, it will cause the death. If this nuclear energy, if the waste of the nuclear energy are released in the, or basically people get exposed to that, that is going to basically cause the immediate death or basically different serious kind of health issues. You must have seen some movies like Hulk, Incredible Hulk, how the Incredible Hulk superhero was formed because of a nuclear explosion or radioactive, accident. It was a nuclear accident basically. Although in case of accident, agar isme accident ho jata hai, if there is some kind of accident, this same nuclear energy released in high amount in the environment and also nuclear waste that remains is radioactive and hazardous to the life. Let's talk about the shale gas, syngas, and the coal bed methane gas. The last three topics are left. Actually, the lecture has to be concluded by now. It was 1 hour lecture, but because we are having so much discussion also and so many queries. Yes, Chernobyl series, you can also see that was also a nuclear accident. That there are so many nuclear accidents that took place in in whole world. Chernobyl is also example of that. Exactly. Shale gas. What is shale gas? Shale gas is a gas trapped in the sedimentary shale rock formations. Sedimentary shale rock means the rocks which are inside the earth. Rocks inside earth. In crust of earth. So we know that earth is made of three layers, that is core, mantle, and crust. These are the three layers of the earth. So in the crust is basically nothing but it is also part of lithosphere, which basically contains the sedimentary rocks. These sedimentary rocks have some gases which are trapped, some kind of gases are trapped inside the sedimentary rocks, and from that gas you get shale gas. It is a very new technology which has been explored recently. USA have been using this shale gas for a very long time. Shale gas is a natural gas trapped within tiny pore spaces in the shale formation. It is a hydrocarbon mixture. It mainly consists of methane. It consists mainly of methane. Other hydrocarbons and natural gas liquid like ethane, propane and butane. And it also contains carbon dioxide, nitrogen and hydrogen sulfide. It mainly consists of methane, but along with methane, it also contains natural gas liquids like ethane, propane and butane and some carbon dioxide, nitrogen, hydrogen sulfide. All these are contained in the shale gas. In the USA, shale gas production has shot up in 2012. So shot up means rise. It has rise in 2012, creating disruption in the global petroleum market. Because USA started using shale gas. So the global petroleum market, they thought that because you know that petroleum market is basically they earn the money basically based by exporting the petroleum, right, to all the countries. Now shale gas production increased in 2012 in USA. So USA started to depend on shale gas for their meeting their energy needs. India has identified 6 basins as area for shale gas exploration. Cambay, Gujarat, Assam, Arakan, Northeast, Gondwana in Central India, Krishna, Godavari onshore, East Coast, Kaveri onshore and Indo-Gangetic basins. So these are the areas in India where shale gas deposits or basins have been explored. Okay, they have been explored. India has not been using, but yes, there are sources of shale gas in India in these 6 basins. Next is called syngas. Syngas is also called as water gas, producer gas. It is also called water gas. Sometimes we call it as water gas, or also called as synthesis gas. Synthesis gas. Syngas or synthesis gas is a fuel gas mixture consisting primarily of hydrogen, carbon monoxide, and very often some carbon dioxide. Okay, so these are the two main constituents of the syngas. Syngas contains hydrogen carbon monoxide, that is hydrogen, 18% of hydrogen, and around 19-20% of carbon monoxide is contained in the syngas along with some carbon dioxide. The names come from this, the names of syngas. from its use as intermediate in creating synthesis natural gas, SNG, and for producing ammonia for methanol. So basically, how we produce this syngas? Syngas is basically produced from coal gasification. It is produced from coal gasification, gasification, or it is also called pyrolysis. Pyrolysis means high temperature. If you heat the solid biomass at a very high temperature in absence of the air. So heating of biomass in absence of air at very high temperature, this is called pyrolysis. So this syngas is produced by the pyrolysis or gasification of the solid biomass, and is basically used in electricity generation. Syngas is combustible and can be used as a fuel of internal combustion engine. The last topic is coal bed methane. That is the last topic. What is coal bed methane? It is also these are all non-renewable energy. We have started to discuss about the non-renewable energy from coal. Then we discuss petroleum, natural gas, nuclear energy, shale gas, syngas, and coal bed methane. These are all non-renewable energy. Okay. Coal bed methane gas. It is a natural gas found in the coal seam. Coal seam means coal deposits. Coal deposits. Also called as sweet gas or coal mining gas. Isko hum log sweet gas bhi bolte hain. We call it as coal mining gas also. It mainly consists of methane with minor amount of nitrogen, carbon dioxide, and heavier hydrocarbon like ethane. Earlier, the CBM, that is coal and methane gas, was wasted and vented out into the atmosphere during mining of the coal. Now, CBM, that is coal bed methanes, it is a short form CBM, is considered as precious energy resource. Extraction requires drilling wells into the coal seams and removing water. Coal seam means the coal deposits. There are some coal deposits in the coal mines. In that coal mines, you drill some well, and from that well, this gas is going to come. That is called as coal bed methane gas. So coal bed methane gas will come from this coal seam. This is the coal seam. You can see that. You can see this coal seam. It is nothing but coal, deposits of the coal. Now let us solve some questions. So these questions are basically some previous year questions and also some new questions that have been asked. Okay, so I will discuss both the type of question, previous year as well as new questions. This question came, I think, in the previous year exam. This is a previous year question. So you can understand by going through this free crash course series, are you able to solve the previous year questions or not? What are the limitations of solar energy? This is a previous year question came in the exam. Firstly, they have written the collecting solar energy over large areas and converting into other form that can be conveniently transported, stored, and used in existing equipment is not economical. Low density of solar energy is compared to coal, oil, and gas. What are the limitations? Now, this question can be solved even just by looking at the options. In the third option, they are writing major applications. You have to find the correct answer. Limitations. See, applications can never be limitations. Applications can never be limitations. So obviously, option number 3 is not correct. So answer will be option number B. It is very obvious that limitations. How can the limitation be application? In the last option, they have written its major applications are photothermal conversion, solar water heating, greenhousing technology, and photovoltaic conversion. These are the limitations. How can you say that limitations are applications? So that is why this option is not correct. So automatically the answer will be option number B. Okay. Is it clear to everyone or not? Next question. Hydrogen fuel cells are emerging as a fuel for the future due to its potential to address the energy crisis. Consider the following statement regarding this. This is also a previous year question. Hydrogen fuel cell convert chemical energy into electrical energy. They are more environment friendly as compared to other fuels like coal and natural gas. The only concern is release of carbon dioxide and excess heat after the reaction. So tell me, during hydrogen fuel cell use, do you get excess of carbon dioxide or water? What comes out? See, I can reply for your question. What question you are having, Prasanna? Telegram link. See, Telegram link, you can wait for the Telegram link. Right now, the more important is to understand the questions. So you need to understand the chronology. Firstly, you need to focus on the lecture. After the end of the lecture, if you are having any general query, you can ask it. Read a simple chronology of these lectures. Okay. So yes, this is not correct. Select the correct code. The correct code will be option number B. Because in hydrogen fuel cell, you get water, electricity, and some heat. But carbon dioxide is not produced during the hydrogen in the use of hydrogen fuel cell. That is not correct. Next question. Consider the following statement regarding, this is also a previous year question. Consider the following statement regarding solar energy. To encourage the adoption of solar energy production, many state government and center have announced plans by the way of buyback as well as subsidy for installation. Basically, the first statement wants to tell us that to encourage the adoption of, that is to increase the solar energy production in the country, you know that nowadays people are using solar panels on the roof or on the roof of their houses. Nowadays, this technology is nowadays used so many in many places, in the hospitals, not in their houses, hospitals, colleges, railways, everywhere they are using this technology, and also in the residential houses, people are using the solar panels. The state government, central governments are providing the subsidy for that. Okay. Land acquisition of several hectares is a bottleneck. Bottleneck means it is kind of a, we can say, it is kind of a problem for this, because you require a large amount of land for getting this, this solar energy, for using that, for installing a power plant. You require a large amount of land. That is important. Considerable R&D effort is needed to bring down the cost of PV cell. I told you, PV cells or solar cells are very costly, are very expensive. So definitely some kind of R&D is required. So answer will be option number C, 1, 2 and 3. Okay. So the right answer will be option number. Next, एक numerical question भी आपके previous year में पूछा गया है from the biogas plant. What is the biogas plant? Firstly, you need to understand what is a biogas plant. In this question, they have asked in the exam, they have given number of cows, retention time, temperature, dry matter consumed, biogas yield, efficiency of the burner, methane proportion, heat of the combustion of methane, density of the dry material in the fluid, power available from digester. What? To understand this, this is a biogas plant. In the biogas plant, what is being done? In the biogas plant, basically, the biogas is produced from here. This is called a biogas plant. Okay. And in this biogas plant, basically, what you will be having? You will be having this side. This is an entry. This is an entry. At the entry side, you will be having a slurry of cattle dung. That is, cow dung means gobar of the cow, gobar of the buffalo, and all that can be used, that will be mixed with the water. Slurry means, what is slurry? Slurry is basically a mixture of cow dung and water. These two are mixed together and they will be sent to this biogas plant. Okay, and here what will happen, they will be having anaerobic decomposition इसे कहते हैं इसको सड़ाना. एनारोबिक डिकम्पोजिशन मींस डिकम्पोजिशन ऑफ द ऑर्गेनिक मैटर. दिस ऑर्गेनिक मैटर व्हिच इज द काउ डंग एंड वाटर, दिस स्लरी इज डिकम्पोज्ड. इट विल टेक सम टाइम एंड दैट टाइम टेकन फॉर डिकम्पोजिशन, टेकन फॉर डिकम्पोजिशन इज रिटेंशन टाइम. उसको हम रिटेंशन टाइम कहते हैं. इट कैन बी 30 डेज और 20 डेज. How much time this slurry is going to remain in this biogas plant, and after that time this biogas is going to come. The biogas is going to start to come from this slurry. जैसे कुछ चीज सड़ जाती है, जब कोई चीज सड़ जाती है उससे गैस निकलने लग जाती है ना, right? So during decomposition, for it will take a period of 20-30 days. After that biogas is going to come. That biogas can be transferred with the help of a wall. And it can be stored. It can be used for different application. Okay. And the excreta of this, whatever will remain here, that is the sludge. Sludge is basically nitrogen-rich fertilizer. It can be used as a nitrogen-rich fertilizer. Sludge is the remain of this. It can be used to improve the fertility of the soil. Now you can see this question. Number of cows used are 5. Retention time is 20 days. That is 20 days is the time which will be taken for making the biogas. Temperature which is there, that this is the amount of temperature which will be maintained in that biogas plant. Dry matter consumed. Amount of dry matter means the gobar, cow dung. The cow dung which is consumed is 2 kg per day. This is the amount of the cow dung which is consumed here. Biogas yield, the amount of biogas which is produced is 0.24 meter cube per kg. This amount of biogas produced. Efficiency of the burner. Burner means the burner which is making the biogas, it is having 50% efficiency. Methane proportion is 0.8. Heat of the combustion of methane is this much. Now, how can you solve this question? So, very simple. Total dry matter consumed. Total dry matter consumed will be how much? What is the total dry matter consumed? See, dry matter consumed per day is 2 kg per day. Number of cows used are 5. So, ek cow ka dry matter ke, this is a dry matter of one cow. Ek cow se aapko 2 kg per day milta hai. Total 5 cows are there. So, total dry matter will be 5 into 2. That is 10 kg per day. From 5 cows. Right? 5 cow hai na, they are total 5 cows, so dry matter consumed, that is cow dung will be total 10 kg per day. Okay, now biogas yield. So biogas yield will be, total biogas yield is 0.24 meter cube per kg. So total biogas yield kitna ho jayega? Total biogas yield will be 10 into 0.24, that is 2.4 meter cube per day. This is a total biogas which is produced, right? Now, in that biogas produced, the methane proportion, you know that biogas mainly contains methane. So, what is the amount of methane? The amount of methane is, in biogas, what is the amount of methane in biogas is 0.8. So total methane kitna ho jayega? 2.4 into 0.8. Okay. Efficiency of the burner is also given 60%. If you take this into account, okay, taking efficiency of burner also, because burner ki efficiency 60%, it is having taking efficiency is equal to 60%, 0.6. So total methane will be 0.6 into 2.4 into 0.8. But you have to find the power available. Power available will be in megajoule per day. This is megajoule per meter cube. And this is meter cube per day. So power available will be equal to what? Power available from digester. What will be the power available from digester? It will be 0.6 into 2.4 into 0.8 into 28. If you solve this, you will get the answer. You will get the answer in megajoule per day. Tell me the answer quickly. You will get 32.256 megajoule per day. So the answer will be approximately option number C. Approximately you will get 32.3 megajoule per day. This is the amount of the power which will be available from the digester. Clear everyone? So this numerical, this is a previous year question. You will see, if you think that this is why we are solving this question, is a previous year question that came in the exam. Okay, approximately you will get 32.3 megajoule per day. That is the power which will be produced from the digester. Let us see one question with reference to two non-conventional fuels called coal bed methane and shale gas. Consider the following statement. Coal bed methane is a pure methane gas extracted from coal seams, while shale gas is a mixture of propane and butane only that can be extracted from fine grain sedimentary rocks. Yes, correct. 32.25. Very good. In India, abundant coal bed methane source exists, but so far no shale gas sources have been found. So the second statement here is not correct. This is not correct because there are six basins of shale gas explored in India. So they are saying that there is no shale gas source in India, but there are six basins already discovered in India. What are those six basins? These are the six basins. You can see that. That is Kambe in Gujarat, Assam, Arakan in Northeast, Gurnavna in the Central India, Krishna Godavari. So these are the six basins which have been found for shale gas. So this is not correct. What is the first one? Coal bed methane is a pure methane gas extracted from coal sinks, while shale gas is a mixture of propane and butane only. That is not correct. So the answer will be option number D for this question. Because coal bed methane may be a pure methane gas, but shale gas is not just a mixture of propane and butane only, because shale gas contains mainly of methane. Along with that, it contains ethane, propane, butane, carbon dioxide, nitrogen and hydrogen sulfide. All these comes under shale gas. So both these statements are incorrect. Both these statements are incorrect here. So answer will be option number D for this question. Neither one or two is correct. Last question for this session. Hurry up guys. We have planned this session for 1 hour, but it has extended to 1 hour 30 minutes because there was so much thing to cover in one lecture, and that too we have to solve the questions. How it is possible to cover that in 1 hour? So that is why lecture has extended. This is also previous year question. You are having two statements. Statement 1, green energy refers to one which does not harm the ecosystem of the planet Earth. What is green energy? Obviously, what is green energy is nothing but green energy is a renewable energy which do not cause pollution. Because renewable energy do not cause any pollution. So, what will be the answer for this question? All renewable energy is green energy. Green energy does not cause pollution. The answer will be option number B. See, firstly, green energy is one which does not harm the ecosystem of the planet Earth. All renewable energy is a green energy. But these two statements are not having any kind of relation. The option number statement 2 is not doing any explanation to statement number 1. These two are the two statements. Both are individually correct. But second statement is not making any explanation. It is not the explanation of the first statement. Statement 2 is not doing the explanation here. Okay, so that is why the answer will be option number B for this question. both are individually correct. Both statement 1 and 2 are correct, but statement 2 is not the correct explanation of statement 1. So that is all in this session. This was the last question. And with this, the topic is completed. We have planned the lecture for 1 hour, but it has went to 1.5 hour, 90 minutes. Tomorrow the class will be, this is a schedule of the classes. Tomorrow the class will be 6th of May. It will be on ecology, ecosystem and biodiversity. This will be the topic of tomorrow lecture. So we'll see you in tomorrow session of ecology, ecosystem and biodiversity at 11:30 a.m. in the morning, same timing. Timing is fixed. And this is a schedule of the classes that I will be taking for this subject up to 10th of May. This is a complete schedule. So that is all in the session. It's time to wind up the session, but the PDF of this session will be provided on Gate on our Telegram channel on do you know the name of the Telegram channel on our Telegram channel of Grade Up Gate. In the Telegram channel of Grade Up Gate, you will find the see, yeah, PDF of this session will be available in the Telegram channel, okay, of Grade Up Gate. The link for channel are given in description. Okay, in the description of the video, you can find the link for the Telegram channel. Direct link, you don't have to search anywhere. Direct link is given. You can join the Telegram channel. Okay. So that is all in this session. If you have enjoyed this session, then please do not forget to like it, share it and subscribe to our YouTube channel and press the bell icon so that you never miss any videos from our YouTube channel. I hope you all have, what is no? Hello sir, can you provide these notes? Prasanna, I will provide the notes. I have already told you that the notes will be available on the Telegram channel. Okay. So I have also told the name of the Telegram channel, that is Grade Up EAC Gate. Let me search the okay. The link of the Telegram channel I think is given. Yeah, if you see the description at the very end of the description, at the very end, in the last, at the very last, you can find the, you can reach out to us on Telegram. The link for the Telegram is also given. So you can just search, click on that link and you can find our Telegram channel. So it is provided at the exact end of the description. Okay. Link is not working. Okay, link is not working. So I am going to tell you the name of the channel. This is the name of the channel. Grade Up Gate. You have to search Grade Up Gate. This is the name of the Telegram channel. So we have got two Telegram channel. It is for all the branches. This is a common Telegram channel for all the branches. And we also have a particular channel for mechanical, that is Grade Up ESC and Gate / ME preparation. So I will upload the PDF on both the Telegram channel. Okay. This is only for mechanical. I will upload the PDF in both the channel. So Telegram pe aap search kar sakte hain. You can search this on Telegram. So you can search this on the Telegram also and you can find the link for the channel. Okay. Are these classes live? See, these classes will be live and after the live, it will be recorded. It will be available in recorded form also. So once the session will be completed, it will be recorded in, it will be available in recorded form also. Thank you so much for joining me for today's session. Have a nice day. Take care. Bye bye everyone. Thank you everyone. We'll see you tomorrow at 11:30 a.m. Okay. So thank you so much. See you tomorrow. Till then, take care everyone. Have a nice day. And if you have liked the session, then do not forget to like it, share it, and subscribe our YouTube channel. Thank you so much. So, grade up ke saath sahi prep hai to life set hai. So, please follow our classes. Thank you so much. Take care, everyone.